here in the British capital as bombs tear into the transit system.
There was this awful screaming of people like, just help, help, help.
Today on News and Review, the London bombings. Hello, I'm Carla Robinson. The first attacks came the morning of July 7th. Four suicide bombers triggered their explosives within minutes of each other, blowing up subway trains and a bus as people made their way to work. The first explosion happened near the Liverpool Street subway station. That's not too far from the Tower of London and Tower Bridge. Minutes later, an explosion near King's Cross Station, the British Museum, relatively close by. Then yet another bomb near Edgware Road. The fourth explosion blew the top off a double-decker bus. More than 50 people were killed, hundreds were hurt. Here's the report the CBC's Don Murray filed the night of the bombings.
Four bombs in less than an hour. The shock of survivors. The shock of mass death. London has been attacked before, but not like this, and not in this century. It began at 8:51 this morning in one of London's subway trains. The blast killed seven people and trapped dozens more underground, choking in smoke in dark cars. At this point, the authorities thought they were dealing with a power surge. A woman who took the subway for the first time told how the trip ended.
A ball of fire came in, and then just everyone started shouting. Everything started getting like dusty, and we were trapped. We couldn't break the windows of the carriage. Everyone was like literally couldn't breathe, and everyone went down. We kind of calmed down, everybody calmed down. But then you started listening to the people shouting on the carriage that blew up, and there was this awful screaming of people like, just help, help, help. And it's just indescribable.
All the windows came in and none of us knew what happened. And it was mayhem. And then the driver came out of the carriage, and which was quite scary because he shone a red light, and I thought I was dead.
At 8:56, another explosion on another line. This was the most devastating. More than 20 people were killed. The police now understood that this was no accident. A third bomb exploded on a third line at 9:21. London's underground, which carries 8.5 million people a day, was shut down. This was the aftermath, as recorded by a passerby's mobile phone.
Next thing I know, there's a large flash of light. Felt a burning sensation on my hands, put my hands up to my face. I was on the floor by that point. As soon as I realised, there'd been an accident, got up, had a look around, saw where the exits were. The train was a complete standstill, lights are out, a lot of smoke in the carriage. On the tube, there's about maybe six, seven people lying on the floor. A lot of people with a lot of blood on their faces and ripped clothes.
In streets that were suddenly empty, emergency services personnel rushed to treat the wounded. There were more than 700 of them, almost 50 in critical or serious condition. Despite the fact that London was short more than 1,500 police on duty in Scotland at the G8 summit, the emergency response was rapid and smooth. And then in a quiet downtown square, a bomb on a bus at 9:47. At least two dead and more chaos. The entire public transport system was suspended. The explosion echoed off the buildings in the square. Debris from the blasted bus scarred those buildings, and police tried to determine whether this was the work of a suicide bomber. There had been no warning. The police said the intent had been to wreak havoc and mass murder.
This clearly was a callous attack on purely innocent members of the public, deliberately designed to kill and injure innocent members of the public.
British Prime Minister Tony Blair flew back from Scotland to London to chair a cabinet security meeting. He was the first to hint that the attacks bore the mark of Al-Qaeda.
When they try to intimidate us, we will not be intimidated. When they seek to change our country or our way of life by these methods, we will not be changed. When they try to divide our people or weaken our resolve, we will not be divided and our resolve will hold firm.
In a side street tonight, proof of the resilience of Londoners.
Our firepower is to have a nice drink after work and show them we're not bothered. We're not bothered by this. You know, they can do it again tomorrow.
But not bothered. You know.
No.
The people who died in the bombings came from different parts of the world and from different backgrounds. There were no Canadians among them, but there were people from Australia, from Poland, from Sierra Leone, and of course from Great Britain. Young and old were among those killed, Christians and Muslims. But Muslim extremists were accused in the attack. So while Britain's large Muslim community grieved, it also worried about a backlash. The CBC's Azawolde Georgis reports.
Just a few blocks from one of the sites where the bombers struck, Muslim Friday prayers as usual. But many here are fearful of whether they could be the target of revenge.
The Muslim community, they're quite in fear and feeling that there may be some reprisal attacks from those who feel they want to let their anger out at Muslims rather than seeing what happened yesterday as really something barbaric, something that cannot be justified by any religion whatsoever.
The Muslims of London are victims as much as their fellow citizens.
Inside, the Imam's message was clear.
The evil people who planned and carried out these indiscriminate acts of terror in London are criminals. No religion can accept that what they have done.
Yesterday's bombers did not discriminate. This man is praying for his granddaughter. 20-year-old Shara Akhtar has been missing for 24 hours.
When he's young, you know,
I used to look after her when she was young, he says, visibly shaken by his loss.
I have no words to say. I just hope she will turn home.
Four bombing scenes, more than 5,000 hours of security camera video, about the same number of tips phoned into police hotlines, a huge investigation. And about 5 days after the bombings, police had an idea of who did it.
Just take a leaflet there. Anything you know, anything suspicious, help us.
Four young British-born men had been identified as the suicide bombers. Three of them were from the northern city of Leeds. Hasib Hussein was 18. Shahzad Tanweer, 22, lived with his parents. Mohammed Sadiq Khan was a youth worker. Another alleged bomber lived in Aylesbury, just north of London. Images captured by security cameras included this one of the four alleged bombers arriving at a subway station the morning of the attacks. While the investigation moved along, Londoners tried to move on with their lives, tried to get used to taking the subway again. But the fear returned on the morning of July 21st. David Common reports.
Once again, the emergency services went into crisis mode. Once again, passengers ran from attack.
I have to ask you to move back a bit further to the next junction.
At midday, the sinister mirror image of the attacks exactly 2 weeks ago. Four separate, nearly simultaneous incidents. Three on board subway trains, the fourth on a bus. Underground, there was panic. In the escape, women literally ran out of their shoes. This passenger thought it was all over.
All I thought is, when am I gonna go off? That's it. That's all that came to my mind. I made my prayer, I hauled to the bar, and I waited for it to happen. That's all that came to my mind.
Just to wait there for a second. Put your bag on the floor, please.
Police suggest at least four bombers boarded London's transit system with the intention of executing a mimic attack. And yet, unlike July 7th, no one was killed or seriously injured after every device failed. At both Warren Street and Oval stations, passengers reported an explosive pop from men's backpacks. In both cases, the men fled, passengers chased, but missed the two.
The guy just escaped, so we don't know, but a lot of people saw it and made a description to the police.
Investigators believe the unexploded bombs will lead officers to who built them and those who carried them.
We do believe that this may represent a significant breakthrough, in the sense that there is obviously forensic material at these scenes which may be very helpful to us.
The police commissioner was right. Clues from the unexploded bombs and these images from security cameras helped investigators zero in on the suspects quickly. About a week after the failed attack, the four would-be bombers were under arrest. Police also had one big failure in their investigation. The day after the attempted attacks, police shot and killed a man at a subway station. They thought he was acting suspiciously. He was actually a young electrician from Brazil who had nothing to do with the bombings. By mid-August, British police had several people under arrest, and the British government had introduced sweeping new legislation to increase security. The CBC's Chris Brown has that story.
On high alert, but dealing with the extremist threat will require more than just guns, says the British Prime Minister.
Let no one be in any doubt. The rules of the game are changing.
Blair's new rules would give the government sweeping powers to deal with radicalism. Mosques could be closed and imams and other religious leaders screened for radical views. And from now on, any foreigner caught promoting hatred or advocating violence risks being deported immediately without appeal.
But if you come to our country from abroad, don't meddle in extremism. Because if you meddle in it or get engaged in it, you're going to go back out again.
All this stems in part from the realization that three of the four July 7th suicide bombers were British-born Muslim men who became radicalized. Keeping out foreign influences is part of the solution, so says Blair is ensuring that more Muslims become integrated into mainstream society so that extremism will find fewer converts. Even before this, Muslims were complaining of heavy-handedness. The police singled them out for spot searches. And in this Arab neighborhood, few like the new measures or the scrutiny.
How are you going to screen them? What other factors are you going to use? And what do you mean you want to close down mosques? You know, to give the view that mosques are the problem is actually to avoid the reality of the situation.
It's all about the foreign policy that Britain's using now. Let's just say the war in Iraq, that's what's causing all the terrorism in this country.
A and others against.
Then there are the courts, which have invalidated recent anti-terrorism laws, saying they infringed on too many civil liberties. But in light of July 7th, who knows what will happen, say critics.
One of the most troubling things about the Prime Minister today is that he was almost goading our higher courts. He was almost saying, I'm going to deport people to face torture. Let's see if the courts are going to have a go in the current climate.
The measures are aimed at what Blair calls a fanatical fringe, not the decent, law-abiding Muslim community. But many of them have nonetheless been caught up in a backlash. Police report hate crimes directed at British Muslims are now six times higher than before the July 7th attacks.
And there are other consequences too, economic ones. According to some estimates, the bombings could cost the British tourist industry a lot of money, more than $1 billion Canadian. And that's News in Review. I'm Carla Robinson. Thanks for watching. Quake.
We have nothing. We're finished.
Tens of thousands of people killed, millions affected.
When I drive for hours, I just see hours of destruction. Valley after valley, plane after plane of destroyed homes, of thousands, tens of thousands of people on the move.
So much suffering and too little aid. On News in Review today, tragedy in South Asia. Hello, I'm Carla Robinson. On October 8th, an earthquake cleaved through northern Pakistan and India. This part of the world is prone to earthquakes, and while this one wasn't the strongest, it will leave a devastating scar. More than 50,000 people were killed. Many, many more lost their homes. In the aftermath, there were desperate calls for help, calls made more urgent by the approach of winter. But aid was slow in coming. The earthquake reduced entire towns to rubble. Whole buildings heaved up and collapsed. Homes disintegrated. Death came crashing down on so many in an instant. The immediate task was to find and help survivors.
Inshallah. Inshallah. We're hoping for the best.
Inshallah, God willing. The rescue effort was spread over a wide area of Pakistan's northwest frontier and the Pakistani and Indian-controlled areas of Kashmir. CBC reporter Patrick Brown went to the region.
In Muzaffarabad, everyone is homeless. 70% of the houses have been destroyed. The rest are uninhabitable. When the first aid convoy arrived, it was impossible to keep order. Desperate people scrambled for whatever they could grab. My whole family was outside and we didn't have any shelter, she says. Now we have a tent and that's important. Otherwise, all we had was our clothes. Countless towns and villages have yet to see a supply truck.
We have nothing. We're finished.
Many people are complaining that help is too slow to arrive, while hunger and disease are coming too quickly.
They should send at least teams to send food to those people. Clear out the ways and send food to the people and take out everybody who's injured.
But this is difficult terrain, and the earthquake damage is spread over a vast area of three countries, Pakistan, India, and Afghanistan. Many roads are damaged, and many places are accessible only by air. Dozens of helicopters are shuttling back and forth, and more are on their way. But bad weather grounds even these American military Chinooks.
We had a storm blow into the area, into some of the passes that are required to get up into these remote areas. The flight had to come back and land due to the weather.
Today's rain slowed rescue efforts in the air, on the ground, and under the rubble. The earthquake killed thousands of people in an instant. Those buried alive have to be rescued one by one. And it can take days, even when rescuers know where they are.
But it's quite a normal thing to rescue people after 3, 4, 5 days. And we've had several after 8 days. So there's hope yet.
Many Canadians have roots and family in South Asia. They too joined the rescue effort happening tens of thousands of kilometers away. Ron Charles has more on the Canadian aid effort.
Why this beautiful place had to be destroyed like this?
After days of phone calls, Nair Javed knows that the members of her immediate family in Pakistan are safe. But she also now knows that at least 10 members of her extended family died in the earthquake.
I have lost lots of relatives. As the news kept coming, then I found out another relative who was hit by the roof in his own home.
And Javed expects more phone calls to bring more bad news, as do other Canadians. There are an estimated 300,000 people living in Canada with roots in Pakistan. Members of this Toronto mosque raised $150,000 in one evening to help send 3 doctors and medicine to the region.
They're short of doctors. There are many, many hospitals have been destroyed. Even doctors have been destroyed with the hospital. And we're hearing from the Pakistani president, they need help.
Farooq Khan says he has no time to dwell on the devastation in his homeland. There's too much to do, including collecting supplies for an airlift.
It is the time where we need to put our emotions aside and put our head in place and get the things going, because it's a race against time. We have to save lives.
And across Canada, people from India and Pakistan who have seen their two countries at war for years are working together to raise money for disaster relief.
Sometimes, adversity sort of brings you closer, and I believe that that is what has happened.
$125 Abbotsford Thornery donation. Thank you very much.
Radio India in Surrey, BC is holding a radiothon hoping to raise $500,000 for relief efforts in Pakistan.
Nobody think about they are Muslim or Hindu or Sikh or Christian. They just want to donate the money They want to help them.
Helping is being worked into the lessons for these children in a Winnipeg Muslim school.
Because the month of Ramadan is known as what exactly?
And because this disaster comes during the Muslim holy month of Ramadan, traditionally a time for caring and sharing, fundraisers in Canada's Pakistani community expect donations to pour in. Ron Charles, CBC News, Toronto.
The Canadian government helped out as well with the military's disaster assistance response team and money.
It's actually a privilege to be able to do this type of work on behalf of Canadians, and we really hope that we make them proud. Push up.
The DART operation includes more than 200 soldiers and equipment.
Yeah, she's not crying now, so that's a good thing.
They set up a mobile hospital in a girls' college to treat the injured.
There's so many patients at the beginning that they overwhelmed the healthcare system here. They were given a quick cast, a quick dressing, and sent out, and now we're seeing their follow-up about 10 days later.
Get right here, okay?
Medical aid and clean drinking water, that's DART's specialty, but it's not cheap and it's controversial.
I think it is a real public relations undertaking.
Aid agencies like Care Canada say they could do a lot more with a lot less.
I would be very surprised if they're not doing the work at about 10 times what the cost of a humanitarian agency would be doing it.
But UN aid officials were grateful for any help they could get. Millions of people were affected by this disaster. 4,000 schools were destroyed. It's a logistics nightmare, and the UN appealed over and over for the world to do more. Reporter Paul Workman talked to the CBC's Peter Mansbridge about what he was hearing from aid officials in the earthquake area.
There seems to be a